this is the wastewater treatment plant for LA County called the Lancaster Wastewater Treatment Plant, just east of Highway 14. I'll take a tour of this today to see where all the water from Lancaster is recycled.
Right at the fairgrounds, just a couple off ramps down, is the old Lancaster plant, which went online in 1941. So the Lancaster Water Reclamation Plant has really been in service since 1941. But we got a new home in 59, where there was a lot more room to expand. So we've been here ever since. And we've gone up, we're now an 18 million gallon a day plant. Although I think right now we're treating somewhere around 15. About 15 million gallons a day. Is that right, Karen? 14 points
something? A little bit more.
Is it, what are you, what is?
Six.
Are you up to 16 already?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. You know,
you're close.
I look at the effluent numbers, which are like 13.7, 13.8
right.
on the effluent side.
Because we need solids and all that.
Yeah, I mean, wash water and all those things. So okay, yeah, good. Thank you, Karen. So we're up to about 16 million gallons a day. A little bit bigger than the Palmdale plant. The Palmdale is pushing 10 million gallons. I know a lot of you guys, I recognize some of you from this morning at the Palmdale plant. This plant is very similar. We're a conventional activated sludge plant with nitrification and denitrification. And if I can just talk about, if I can refer to this board here for a little bit, I think I might just move it over here just for a while, just to make it a little more visible. And here at Lancaster, the influent sewer comes into the plant, where all the sewage comes into the plant. And now, Lancaster is pretty far away from the population center here. We're several miles away from the population center. And so the sewer comes in very deep. There are no pump stations that pump the sewage. Everything comes here by gravity. Although there are a couple of private pump stations. One of them is at a mobile home park. But there are no pump stations in our system, in our main trunk system. Everything is by gravity. And so the sewage comes in at roughly 40 feet deep, almost 40 feet deep at this plant. I want to say it's 38 feet, but I'm going to say roughly 40 feet.
Is this wastewater coming in from Lancaster?
Yeah, it comes
not
in from
like Los Angeles.
No, the wastewater that comes into this plant comes from the city of Lancaster, partly from the city of Palmdale, and from the LA unincorporated areas that are tributary to this plant. Everything flows by gravity, so our plants are served by topography. The, you know, how the water is going to flow determines what our service area is. And so we're a complete gravity system on our service system. And so we come in at almost 40 feet deep. And so that water is pumped up, goes, first thing that happens in our plant as we go through preliminary treatment. And preliminary treatment gets rid of the big stuff, rags, mostly big pieces of wood, large things that would get caught up in a screen or in bar racks. And so that's what happens here. And then also in the preliminary system, we get rid of grit. And grit is stuff like sand, metal, things that would scour pumps, things that would scour chain and sprocket system. Imagine if you got sand in your bicycle chain. You wouldn't want sand in your bicycle chain. And so what we do is we drop out the grit and the big stuff at the very beginning to protect equipment further downstream. Also included in grit are things like eggshells, coffee grounds, things like that that are inert, things that aren't going to decompose later on, that things that wouldn't decompose in the digesters, which we'll talk about later. So once we get through the very preliminary part of the system, we go to our first major treatment unit, which is primary settling. Now, primary settling also includes primary floating, because some things in the waste float and some things sink. So what we want to do is we want to try and remove as many suspended solids as we can. You know, the two major classes of solids would be suspended solids and dissolved solids. Right? Some of the things are suspended in the water and some things are actually dissolved. Like, you know, if you make coffee or tea, those are organics that are dissolved in the water. But if you have things like lettuce, toilet paper, stuff like that, those are suspended solids. So what we want to do in primary settling is remove as much of the suspended salts as we can, as much as possible. Some of it floats, like lettuce. Some of it sinks, like a lot of, you know, and what's in our sewage? I think we know what's in the sewage, right? You know, stuff that we put in the sewage from our bathrooms, stuff that we put in our in the wastewater from our sinks, in laundry, things like that. So some of that's going to sink, some of it's going to float. What sinks are the settleable solids. What floats is the skimmings or the scum. Some people call them skimming, some people call them scum. Scum is a technical term. A lot of our equipment is, you know, we have scum hoppers, scum beaches, things like that. So those are the floatables. And then what's in the middle, you know, you've got your floating and you've got your settling. What's in the middle then is our primary effluent. And the primary effluent is what moves on then to our secondary process. Now, so we've removed a lot of solids already, right? As much of the suspended solids as we can. Because it's easy and cheap. It doesn't cost a lot to float and settle. There's not a lot of energy that goes into that. So we want to remove as much of that as we can for economic purposes. Because we want to make the highest quality water as we can economically, efficiently. And so we want to get as much as we can out of the primary settling basins. So once we remove those solids, those go down into anaerobic digesters. And the anaerobic digesters are very large tanks, and they're very much like our intestines, like our digestive system. They operate at about the same temperature. Our bodies operate at, 96.7, I want to say? 98.7, 98.6, 98.7 degrees Fahrenheit. We operate very close to that temperature, 99 degrees. So we're, 0.3 degrees different Fahrenheit from our bodies. So it's very much like our bodies. And like our bodies, the anaerobic digesters create gas. And we all make a little gas, and so do our anaerobic digesters. And it's the same gas. It's methane and carbon dioxide, biogas. So the methane and carbon dioxide is a product of anaerobic digestion, very much like our bodies. It's almost the same process. A lot of the same microbes, everything, are all involved. So it's very much like what our bodies do. And the whole plant, by the way, mimics nature. We really mimic natural processes, but we just speed them up. We speed them up and accelerate them and do what nature does within a few hours. We do what nature takes months to do. We do it in a few hours here in the plant. So once we've settled out and floated out as much as we can from the primary tanks, then we go from primary to secondary, the secondary process. The primary tank is a physical process. Secondary is a biological process. At the heart of this treatment plant is a biological process that employs microorganisms to eat our waste. We all know that microorganisms like to eat organic matter. You know, the microbes, bacteria, and other microscopic organisms will eat organic matter. So our waste is their food. So we employ them to eat our waste, and it's their food. And just like us, the amount of food that we can eat depends on how big we are. And so the bigger we are, theoretically, the more we can eat. I'm about 200 pounds, give or take. I'm about 180, 190. I don't know, I feel like 200 today after all the donuts that Wendy brought. Thank you, Wendy, for that. But at about 200 pounds, I think I eat somewhere around 5 or 6 pounds a day. You know. And including water and everything, you know. And think about what you eat. Picture all the meals that you eat and how much it is. You know, it's, you know, somewhere around 5 pounds when you put it all together, I think, for me. And of course, the bigger the person is, the more you can eat. Well, so let's go back to our secondary process here. We have all these microbes that we need them to eat our waste, right? In order for the plant to work good. To treat the water nicely, we need them to eat all the food that comes in. So we know about how many pounds of food comes into our plant. Just by analyzing the water, we know what the flow rate is in the plant, we know how much organic matter is in it. So we know about how much food needs to be eaten. So what we have to do is make sure that there are enough microbes to eat that food. And not too surprisingly, it's about the same ratio of pounds of matter to pounds of food. So for about every 200 pounds of microbes, they eat about, you know, 5 to 10 pounds of food. They're very much like us. So, you know, this treatment plant is a lot like our bodies. Not only does it mimic what nature does, but it's a lot like our bodies. in what we call the food to microorganism ratio. How many microbes do we need to eat this food? So in this process, this biological process, we have all these microbes that are hungry and ready to eat our waste. This is how our water is treated. Now, it's important to have not only enough pounds of microbes, but we have to have a real diverse population of microbes. We have to have a lot of diversity in that population because there's a lot of stuff, different stuff in the waste. What's toilet paper made of, for instance? Where does toilet paper come from originally? Trees, yeah, wood, right? So that's cellulose. Now, can our bodies digest wood, cellulose? No. No, we don't. But we're very good. Our bodies are good at eating, at digesting proteins, carbohydrates, fats and oils. We can eat. We can do that. So we need lots of different microbes. Certain microbes are very good at eating cellulose, like the toilet paper. Other microbes are better at eating the fats and greases. Others are really good at eating sugars and other carbs. Some are better at eating proteins. So we have to have a lot of different kinds of microbes to eat all the different kinds of food that come into the plant. Again, our waste is their food.
Can they all live together?
Oh yeah, they all live together in harmony. Yeah, absolutely.
Can I ask a question back up? What happens to the methane gas?
The methane gas is either flared, depending on which treatment plant you're at, it's either flared or it makes energy. This plant has the ability to make about a quarter megawatt of energy from the gas that we produce. And we're currently between energy projects right now. I think our gas turbine was pulled out, I want to say a year ago maybe, and we're looking at other projects now.
You know, that methane can be condensed down to methanol and power cars and trucks.
Yes,
and
that's
it's completely
right.
Pollution free. It's a free, pollution free way to run our vehicles.
That's right. And you know, the other thing that we did, that our most recent energy project in Palmdale was a fuel cell. Because you can take the methane and pull the hydrogen out of it and have very clean power as well. And we ran about a quarter megawatt power plant in Palmdale that was a fuel cell. Mm-hmm. So yeah, methanol, fuel cells, or direct burning of the methane. Because methane is natural gas, so it would be like a natural gas-fired plant, which currently is among the cleanest power plants that are operating on large scale, methane gas plants. But yeah, methanol, we went through the useful life of our last turbine that we had. But there are options. Southern California Gas Company is interested in taking our gas as well, purifying it and putting it into the Southern California gas system. We haven't made any deals yet with anybody yet currently on what's going to happen next. But yeah, it's a valuable resource. And so that's all part of the solid stream. So these microbes, yeah, they do all live together in the same tank. There's a large variety going all the way from single cell microbes all the way up to free swimming microbes like water bears and rotifers and the microbes that we call polishers, because not only do they eat the food, but they'll also eat other microbes that have died, yeah. You know, and so they're polishers. So there's a whole giant diversity in this culture so that we can treat the waste better. And these microbes occur naturally. They will occur naturally, although when the plant is brand new, we'll seed the plant from another plant, or if we have a real big upset, we can bring microbes from other plants to reestablish this population. But they're very robust. They can take a lot. Luckily, these microbes are also a little bit heavier than water. So given the opportunity, they'll settle. And that's really important to us, because after they've eaten, now we settle them out. They settle out very nicely to the bottom. And when we get out, or actually, are the Imhoff cones in here, Junior?
No, they're outside.
Okay, yeah, they're outside. So you'll see we have some big glass cones that you'll see how nicely the microbes settle in this process. They're a little bit heavier than water. We give them the opportunity and they settle really nicely. And then we get a nice clear, what we call the secondary effluent. So this produces the primary effluent. This settling basin produces the secondary effluent. And one of the big differences is that what we're settling in this primary tank are sewage solids. You know, these are actual, you know, toilet paper, vegetable mat, all that stuff. We're settling sewage solids. In the secondary process, we're settling out microbes. The microbes, the good guys that ate the waste. So we're settling out the good guys here. And part of it we waste, but most of it we return back to the aeration basin so that they can so that they can stay in the system. They're still hungry, they're still viable microbes. You can't just waste them out or the population will be gone. You need these microbes. You need a certain number of pounds of microbes. So we waste a little, because if you don't waste any, then the population would just grow and go out of control. So we have to waste just enough to keep the process in balance. So it's like the population of our country. We have a growth rate, we have a death rate. And if they become too out of balance, the population changes, right? Either your population is increasing or decreasing. We want to have basically a zero population growth in our treatment plan. We want it to be balanced, so it's kind of always the same. So we waste just enough to keep the process working nicely. And so the waste goes down and goes through thickening. And so we thicken it up and try to get as much of the water out of it as we can. And then it joins the primary solids in these digesters. So these digesters ultimately take the primary solids and the secondary solids, and then they produce gas, and they produce kind of a soil-like material. Once you've digested out this material, you've let the microbes eat it as much as possible, and there's nothing left to eat. Really, you end up with kind of a soil material, and it's really good to go into farmland, and it goes back mainly into farmland that produces fodder crops for livestock. And right now, most of this is going up to Kern County, to farmlands in Kern County that have a very beneficial use for this material. When you farm a piece of ground for long enough, you strip it of not only the basic nutrients like nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, but you also strip it of the micronutrients that are important, like copper, zinc, and all these little micronutrients that don't get replaced with ordinary fertilizer. So by putting biosolids back into the farmland, you're really making a more sustainable farmland. And so this is good for us, it's good for the farmers, good for the fodder crops.
Do you sell it to them, or do they get it for
free? we deliver it to them for free. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we provide that for them. In some areas, it becomes a marketable product. Like if you go to Home Depot or Lowe's, you'll see Kellogg's. Kellogg's Nitro Humus or Kellogg's Compost. The heart of Kellogg's is biosolids, so it's a valuable material. Up here in the Antelope Valley, we haul it up to Kern, and we don't make a product that goes into stores like that. And we just bring it up to them, and they till it into their soils. And so it's a great relationship for both of us. So that's secondary process. So now we've gone through the primary process, the secondary process, and then finally there's a tertiary plant. So we have a third process, and that's filtration. And at this plant, we run through gravity filters. Gravity meaning that the water just passes through on its own by feeding it at the top of the filter and letting gravity push it through. And what we employ are anthracite coal layers supported by sand, supported by gravel. So that's the multimedia, anthracite coal, sand, and gravel. And the anthracite coal captures the bulk of the little particles. Now at this point, we're not filtering out wastewater particles or sewage particles. What we're filtering out are whatever little microbes that didn't quite settle out, because it's impossible to get every little microbe out. So we catch the last little bits of microbes in the gravity filters. And so by this time, we've basically removed all of the solids from the water. And as you'll see when we show you the samples, it's free of any suspended solids, very clear, beautiful water, actually meets all the drinking water standards. Now, we don't drink it directly, but it does meet all the drinking water standards, all the California drinking water standards. What that means is that we can use it for everything else other than direct potable use. We can irrigate any kind of crop. We can irrigate any kind of field, school, golf course, parks. We can use it for anything except for direct drinking. It meets swimming water standards, so you can swim in it. Mm. It meets all of these standards. We just don't drink it directly, but, you know, all water on this planet goes through the water cycle, and, you know, it'll eventually make its way through the water cycle. So if we just use it for other things, what it does is it offsets the demand for potable use. So rather than using our highest quality potable water for irrigating parks and golf course, things like that, let's use this high quality tertiary effluent instead, and then save the potable water for the highest use.
Is this where Lancaster gets his purple pipe water?
Yes, that's exactly right. And this is it right here. See this arrow that says to municipal use? I apologize. That water goes down the purple pipe, feeds like City Park, right at Costco, yes. Stuff like that. And those uses are growing. Now, it takes time to build the pipelines and get them out to the uses, but the ball is rolling. And now that those pipelines are in place, more and more connections are going to be made, and it'll be used more and more. You're going to see more and more use. Currently, the bulk of the water goes to agricultural use, and this goes out mainly to alfalfa and winter grains like barley, oat, and wheat. Alfalfa is the bulk of the crop. This plant supports about 2,000 acres of alfalfa crops. And so right now, that's where the bulk of the water goes. So we have 100% beneficial reuse of this water, which is unusual. Not too many communities use 100% of their wastewater for beneficial use. But in the Antelope Valley, both in Palmdale and Lancaster, 100% of our tertiary effluent is beneficially used.
Is that water counted into the adjudication and the water settlement, or is that extra from it?
No, this is not part of the adjudication.
Okay, so the farmers still get the benefit of that water without being part of the allotment.
That's right.
Okay.
And one of the reasons is because a large portion of this water originates from the California Aqueduct, is imported. Now, I know that all of the water we use doesn't come from imports. You know, some of it comes from groundwater, but a very large portion does come from the California Aqueduct. So this is water that's added to the valley, to the Antelope Valley, through our import projects, mainly the California Aqueduct. Very good question. Okay, so we go to municipal reuse down the Purple Pipe, we go to ag, and we also support the Paiute Ponds on Edwards Air Force Base, right, Misty? And Misty's going to give us a tour of the Paiute Ponds, which are part of Edwards Air Force Base. And it's the forebay to Roseman Lake Bed. And Roseman Lake Bed and Rogers Lake Bed, the dry lake beds out at Edwards, are a very important part of the Edwards mission. Because these are very smooth, perfectly smooth dry lake beds that are the reason that Edwards Air Force Base is here. Originally, that is why Edwards is here. Because you can land aircraft, very expensive test aircraft, right on a lake bed. These lake beds are so smooth. And they're naturally smooth because occasionally they flood and the wind wave action smooths out that surface. The wind moves the fine sediments back and forth on these lake beds. It makes a perfectly smooth runway quality lake bed. And so so Paiute Ponds feeds into the Roseman lake bed portion of the Air Force Base. Very important part of Edwards' mission. And we're very fortunate to have Misty here today to show us the ponds. And that's going to be part of our tour, part of our bus tour. So now, one important thing that we're also going to visit are the storage reservoirs. Now, since most of our effluent is used for irrigation, we have to recognize that most of the irrigation occurs in the warmer months, in summertime. Almost all of the water that goes to irrigation happens in the warmer months. Very little irrigation occurs in the wintertime. The Antelope Valley is very cold. We freeze regularly in the wintertime. It snows here in the wintertime. And a lot of people don't realize that the Antelope Valley freezes. And so the demand for agricultural water is minimal in the wintertime. So in order to achieve 100% beneficial reuse, we have to store a lot of that water in the wintertime, because the wastewater comes into the plant pretty much the same rate every day. We basically get our 16 million gallons a day on a regular basis, year round. But the demand, on the effluent side, the demand is very seasonal. So what we do is we fill it, and these reservoirs are huge. Here we have 1.3 billion gallons of reservoir storage. In Lancaster, we have 900 million. So between the two plants, we store 2.2 billion gallons of tertiary effluent over the course of the year. And so, or any given time. That's the capacity of those reservoirs, 2.2 billion. And here in Lancaster, we're going to see 1.3 billion of that. And these are lined reservoirs. They're lined with polyethylene so that we don't lose any water. We hold it all in for beneficial reuse. So in wintertime, these reservoirs fill up, usually by about March, they're full. And then over the summer months, when the farms and other irrigation like parks and such are using that water, these reservoirs are depleted by about September, early October. So they'll be almost empty. Not completely empty, because we leave just a couple feet in the bottom in order to hold down that liner and minimize the wind loads on the liner and such. So we always leave a little bit of water in the reservoirs. We take it down to roughly 2 to 3 feet deep, and then we fill them all the way back up again in the next winter. So it's an annual rising and falling of this reservoir capacity. And so that's a critical part of being able to achieve 100% reuse, because the water has to be available when in sync with the demand. So these reservoirs are critical in order for us to achieve that. And we're very proud of the fact that we're able to reuse 100% of our effluent here. Most of Southern California uses about 40% of the tertiary effluent. And until more pipelines are built to bring that water back to recycle water uses, that water will continue to go into the ocean. But our hope is that over time, we'll have 100% beneficial reuse everywhere throughout Southern California, because it's such a critical resource. The Antelope Valley is leading the way. We're already using 100%.
So there are other plants like this scattered around Southern California?
Yes, there are. We're part of an 11 treatment plant system. We have 11 treatment plants total in our system, and we're just two of them up here in the Antelope Valley.
Okay. Our water here, this is the primary effluent. So this is the water that has gone through our primary and preliminary treatment, and as you can see, it's still extremely cloudy. There's a lot of solids that are still dissolved and suspended in this water. We send it to our secondary treatment, where we have activated sludge that works on it, and this one is already actually separated and rose due to the sunlight out here. This is how clear the water is leaving secondary. These are the microbes that Rick was talking about that we use to actually take this cloudiness out and make it this clear. We then filter the water and it comes out this clean. This is the water that's theoretically as clean as any drinking water. Okay? So these are the separations that we'll see as we walk through over here. But this does get water, and this does get sewage also from part of Palmdale as well as like Rosamond, things like that come into this direction. So this is the activated sludge process. This is where the microbes are, the microbiology that we maintain to eat the solids which are still dissolved in that primary. So that cloudiness that you saw in that primary effluent, that first cone, the biological life that we maintain in here, we give them air so that they can continue to live, and we give them food. That food is that haze that's in that first cone that you just saw. So they eat the solids that are there, and then they will get fat and they'll settle in a sedimentation tank, whereas it would not settle in the tank when it was dissolved. And when it's dissolved in the water, gravity can't take it out. After the microbes eat it, we can remove the microbes. Okay?
And is it kind of being aerated by
this? Yeah. There are domes down in the bottom. It's a lot like your fish tank when you have that little charcoal filter with an airline hook to it and all the bubbles start coming out. The same thing, except we've got thousands of these little domes down in the bottom down there, and those are allowing the air, which we have very large air blowers over here in this building that are pushing air through those diffusers, and we have fine bubbles coming up, and those bubbles are all what you see here coming up that the microbes can take oxygen from. Flow comes in at the front end of that first tank, and it serpentines its way through these three tanks. That gives it the time for the microbes to do what they need to do as far as eating the solids that are in that water, so that we can send it to these clarifiers that are behind us. This is a sedimentation system now. The microbes, so that we can get them back into the system and have them start over again. here you can see how much cleaner the water already is. And this is our secondary effluent. So you see we still have some of the microorganisms which have floated up and are still going over. We call that a little bit of like pin drop. So it still is a little bit on the dirty side right here. So we need to filter this now before it's actually completely clean. So a filter go over here.
Well, these are pumps?
These are pumps, and you picked up on something that's a little bit unusual about this facility. I know that when you were talking to Rick, he emphasized a lot about gravity flow.
Right.
And if you notice, before we go up to our filters, which are conventional sand filters, we have to lift the flow.
So those are pumps pulling it up?
Pumps pulling it up from here to our filter bed.
Got it.
So these are our chlorine contact tanks. So after we add chlorine right behind you here where these mixers are for disinfection, the water has to maintain a chlorine residual for a couple of hours to make sure that all the pathogens and the bacteria have been killed. So after we add chlorine, we run it through serpentine channels inside these tanks right here so that it has a couple hours of contact time to make sure that everything is killed and all the water is disinfected. At the point at which the water leaves the plant right over here, it's been about 10 to 12 hours in our facility. And we'll show you, here's a quick sample.
So these are the reservoirs. Again, this complex here made up of four reservoirs. There are two more behind us, right behind the bus, and then of course one on either side of us. They add up to a total of 1.3 billion gallons of recycled tertiary water. You can see there are a lot of birds that use these reservoirs as well. We saw a nice flock of geese on the way in. I don't know if you noticed them. Were they Canadians, Misty?
No, I think they're Spanish.
Snow geese? Okay, they're beautiful. So again, this reservoir fills up right around March, usually, and then it will be depleted right around the end of September, beginning of October or so. Okay, so our next stop is the Paiute Ponds on Edwards Air Force Base.
Edwards Air Force Base and their lake beds are actually the lowest elevation in the Antelope Valley. Where you see the hillsides, all of this back in the Pleistocene. Back in the Pleistocene used to be Lake Thompson. So this entire place used to be filled with water. What you see at Edwards Air Force Base is the residuals of that. So Paiute historically got water from the Amagosa Creek, Cottonwood Creek, as well as Little Rock Creek. Part of the ponds themselves was actually Little Paiute, what we call Little Paiute, was the bottom edge of Amagosa Creek. As the city and the town kind of built itself up, it cut off a lot of that water flow. Not completely, but it's diverting quite a bit. So the wetlands themselves would have a hard time supporting itself without additional input that we get from the wastewater district. Consider an entire wetlands complex. We have over 5,000 acres that we consider part of that complex. Not all of it has water, but it has wetland habitat, whether it's meadows, alkaline sinks, saltbush scrub, clay pans, all the way up into the lake bed. Now, as far as the water control, we can control where the water goes in approximately 1,400 acres. And we do that because, as was mentioned earlier, the lake beds are an important resource for the military as far as doing missions and landing planes. And so we want to be able to control that water, because when the lake bed is wet, it's clay, right? So you drive on it, you get stuck or make a mess, and it's not very pretty. So when they actually do want to do missions out there, we try to keep it dry so we can stop the water from getting there. So, like I said, historically water is always flowing through here. And the military actually took over this piece of land back in the 1940s. First it was Army, eventually it transitioned over to Air Force. And so I think it was back in 1961, the Air Force started worrying about all the water getting onto the lake beds, so District 14 actually built a dike to help prevent some of that water. And then as time has gone on, we've built additional dikes, more capacity, so that we can again do more and more control over what water is going where. But water is an important resource for the lake bed itself. It's important for it to flood. It is a unique ecosystem. Yeah, the roads are a little bumpy. It needs the water because in the lake beds we have fairy shrimp and predator shrimp. We have about seven or nine different species last count, as well as a plethora of invertebrates. And then you also have the cyanobacteria and all the microorganisms. And with the wave action, it does smooth it out, but the microorganism actually creates a seal. So when it dries out, you don't walk on it, you aren't getting puffs of dirt that's coming up. It's completely hard. And that hard surface is what makes it really unique and valuable resource for the Air Force to be able to land on. So ponds themselves, we manage them to have a diversity of habitats. So Edwards Air Force Base and this entire area is our part of the Pacific Flyway, which means we're in the migratory path of all kinds of birds that go from Canada all the way down to Central and South America. We typically get our migrations in the spring, in the summer, and in the fall. So pretty much all year you get something coming through at some point. But so we manage for those migrations. We need different water levels depending on the dominant species of the time. So we typically like to shallow out a lot of our ponds during shorebird migration because they typically don't like anything deeper than 4 to 6 inches. A lot of them even shorter than that, more like 2 inches. But then we get our waterfowl migrations and they like anything from 6 inches to 10 feet depending on the type of duck. So we have the capacity to manage for all of those different species simultaneously. Because not only do we have the migrants, but we also have resident birds. So if you want to go up towards where the porcupine is, that's the first thing. So like the water treatment plant said, we are gravity fed. So where we're going is actually one of the main ponds, kind of the kidney of the entire facility that then shuttles the water to various other areas. We have over 30 weirs, so different water control structures throughout our complex that helps us manage how much water is in each one of those ponds. This is kind of a newer feature for us. Most of them didn't get put in until a couple of years ago, so we're really excited about that and will hopefully help us better manage as time goes on. So even though we are part of a military installation, this particular area is open to the public as long as you go through our screening process. But we have hundreds of birders that come through here every year, and we have a very active hunting program. The hunters are actually out here before the towns were established. We have old hunting facilities, blinds, dikes that they put in way back when. You can actually see some of the structures back in the 1920 aerial photos that we have of this area. But we also have prehistoric evidence that there were hunters out here even then. One of our oldest cultural resources area on the base is out here. And you find these really interesting rock structures called crescents that they theorize were actually used kind of like in a slingshot manner, that they would use them to knock down waterfowl to eat. Because of the crescent shape, it wouldn't obliterate the birds when it hit it, unlike an arrow. So more evidence that this place was always used for hunters. As you look to your left, this area over here is part of Little Paiute, one of our ponds. And then once we get past these tamarisk trees, we'll have the shuttle pond. So Little Paiute is that area that I originally told you was originally part of Amagosa Creek that fed into Rosemond Lake bed. And you'll notice that we have a lot of tamarisk trees at our complex. That is evidence of homesteading that used to happen out here. But we have an active program going on right now that we're actually trying to improve habitat quality. So slowly but surely, we will likely be getting rid of a lot of our tamarisk trees. Maybe not all of them, because they're considered an important cultural resource, but we're working on it. And something that we do here is we're constantly trying to improve the habitat. So we have really good volunteer group that comes in. We've been planting riparian areas to hopefully draw in some southwestern willow flycatchers, as well as Bell's Vireo. Those little PVC pipes that you see outside the window are part of the willows that we just planted this last week. So we're very excited about them. We're going to take a little walk because this place is amazing and you should see it firsthand. And over 500 different invertebrates fossil from that. And that's everything from butterflies to fairy shrimp, spiders, scorpions, and three different species of scorpion. So we're going to walk this way. It's not dangerous. Nothing for fishing.
Bring out a bucket of trout fingerlings.
I don't know if it's the last very long. One of the main food sources out here is actually African clawed frogs, which are an invasive species and they're actually a real problem in other areas. But here, they provide a very important food resources. We've seen everything eat them from egrets and herons to so everything seems to like the frogs.
I've never seen
them out here. What do
they look like?
I'm not sure
they're
really fast.
Got started.
So again, here's some willow saplings to our left.
or try and create some riparian areas as we start taking out more and more bitumen streams. We'll hopefully lure some of our more threatening and endangered songbird species that we have come through the area. So we have plenty of nesting birds. One of the more important ones that we have in this area and at another water resource on the base is tricolored blackbirds, which have been in a recently good position that we put on the front of the base. So I'm through its 30-day review period right now, so So this particular area we call Peace Loop. A lot of those water birds that you're seeing in the coast. But we're at the tail end of duck season. A lot of our ducks are going on, but as of a week and a half ago, we also have a lot of really important relationships with the community as well as nonprofits. Right now we're currently lowering what we call North View, North Ducks Unlimited ponds, which you see to your left. We're working with Ducks Unlimited, which is a nonprofit organization. They're going to come in and help us fix an algae problem that we have, probably because of some stagnant water. But this area is open. I was asked, so I'm just going to announce it. This area is open year-round. We do, during duck season, limit the amount of other recreational use on those particular kinds of days, which are just a couple of days during the week, just because they're not conducive recreational activities with one another. But we have everything from bird watchers to nature photographers, hikers. We have school groups that come through here on a regular basis. If you're part of the local community, the Mojave Ecosystem Educational educational kit for wetlands habitat. So that rotates through the schools, and they use them as different units in the schools. But we come out here, we look at animal tracks, we do birding. We have a lot of our local community that's been really great in supporting us. So we have a lot of the Audubon societies that come out here on a regular basis. And other birding and recreational groups. Let's see, what else can I tell you? There's so much to say.
You mentioned the wildlife that's out here. I'm assuming coyotes and bobcats. Do you get anything larger, like bighorn sheep?
We don't have any sheep. The biggest mammal that we used to have on Edwards Air Force Base were wild burros. But they were removed when the Air Force took over, just because they kept going on the runways and it was dangerous. So we moved them out to China Lake. The biggest mammals that we have are coyotes and bobcats. We also get kit foxes out here. We have raccoons. We get ringtails. We even have muskrats that are out in the ponds, as well as a lot of the smaller mammals. This is a remnant. We have a remnant population of California voles, which weren't really thought to be in the Mojave Desert anymore because of all the damage to the riparian areas. But we still have a remnant population here, which is great because we also have kites too, which you wouldn't normally get in this environment unless those were here. We had our first successful nest last season, so it means we're doing a good job, hopefully, managing the habitat.
Have you come across a desert tortoise lately?
Not in this particular area. Tortoises don't tend to do well around developed areas for multiple reasons. Feral dogs is a big one, and we do get feral dogs out here on occasion, but also development and stuff. Saltbush scrub habitat, while it is still habitat for them, isn't the best, most productive habitat for them. So even when they were here, they were probably in fairly low densities. We do get low densities from the other side of the pond still. We find evidence occasionally, but I've never seen them as close to the fence. But we do have
desert tortoises throughout our base, and that's one of the major animals that we manage for here. We have projects and things that we want to do on the base. One of the things that we do is we go through an environmental review process. So we evaluate what's going on and where and what potential effects that could have on the wildlife, as well as other resources we have, whether it's floodplains or it's cultural resources or other things that are going on the base. And when we evaluate what that is, then we can apply mitigation, whether it's to move that project to an area that has much of an effect on those resources, or develop ways of doing that project and minimizing the effects that we have to the animals. We do monitor their populations. We do density surveys every 10 years or so throughout the base, just kind of see what their population levels are doing. We do a lot of education here on the base. Information from birding that happens out here, different species lists, maps, information about our hunting program out here and other recreational uses. It also has my contact information in there, so if you do want to come out and recreate out here, you have a group you want to bring out here, contact me to help organize that for you. Yes.
Are you considered a civilian employee or are you actually part of the Air Force?
I am a civilian employee, but I am funded through DOD as part of the Air Force civilian staff. Yeah.
You planned anything for habitat?
We planted anything. So, as we were walking in, I was showing you the willows that we just planted. So we do have an active tree planting that we're trying to do to restore some habitat as well as keep up with our tamarisk removal. But we do have some hunters that have gone through and planted some duckweed and some smartweed and some timothy grass, which are all really good high protein food resources for ducks. So we have some of those that are planted throughout the ponds that help out during duck season, during our migratory. But beyond that, we haven't done a lot of plantings. In the last few years, we've had a few monarch butterfly sightings, which we are also very excited about. Probably by one of the future projects could be planting some food resources for them to help them continue on the migratory path. If they are part of that path, it usually goes through Bakersfield. They miss us, but occasionally we get the residuals. yeah, we also have, this is one of the top birding spots in all of California. We have people that come from all over the United States, as well as people from all over the world come here. Because we have some species that are really rare, but they're actually hard to see out here, including the California thrushes. Taking over certain areas, and we do have an active management program for them. We have a contract out right now that will be coming in and doing some treatment. Probably the end of the spring season and into the fall, but it's a multi-year project. We also noticed in the last few years the pepper weed, an annual pepper weed, which is small enough right now that hopefully we can take care of before it takes over. Because in a wetland environment, the problem is you don't want a species that's going to totally outcompete everything else, because that ruins the heterogeneity that a lot of the species depend on. So it's those species that we're really actively controlling. We also have a weed that's coming up, you probably see it everywhere, which isn't a huge problem. It's called five-hook bassia. It does provide a good food seed source for a lot of birds, but our problem is in certain areas it is taking over. So we have volunteer projects that are ongoing that kind of help us get in and start removing some of it, as well as our tree planting. Our volunteers, they also come out and they do trash removal because it's a desert, we have people dumping a lot, especially near our gate, not necessarily in the installation, but sometimes. They also keep an eye out for us of people doing things that they shouldn't be doing, which is nice. But we also have people that come out and they do research. So, like I said, the ruminant vole population, we had a local university that came out and actually did genetic studies to kind of figure out where they belong, as far as all of the voles, whether they're from the northern or southern populations. We've had engineering researchers come out with different technologies to try to figure out if they can figure out how much capacity a pond can hold or a water resource by doing aerial photography. We have an active sensitive species project going on right now that's looking at our mostly the tricolored blackbirds, but also other species of birds that are coming through, figuring out what resources they're using, how many do we have, because the tricolors were actually petitioned to be listed this last year as part of the Federal Endangered Species Act. As threatened because their populations are in major decline here in California and other important places. And we have a pretty stable population here, as of right now. So we want to make sure that it stays that way. But we also have a lot of other sensitive birds that are starting to come in on the riparian areas that we are constructing, or to hopefully bring in some more of those like southwestern little flycatchers. Had a yellow resource, like I said, because a lot of the natural water flow that would come through the area has been diverted through building of the local communities. We couldn't survive without the wastewater treatment plant helping us supplement that. We do still get natural flows. It takes at least 2.5 inches during a rainstorm to get surface flow that will actually get down here. But we still do get some residual flow from the Amagrosa Creek as well as the Little Rock Creek. And it actually parallels the northern ponds right back there. Really past.
Yeah,
very much. We really appreciate you taking the time to visit us. And just as a reminder, if you would be kind enough to sign in on the sign-in sheet, we'd be happy to contact you again next year. Because we do these tours once a year, and they're normally in February or March. So if you do sign in, we can not only get a good head count, but we can contact you again to invite you again. And if you have any other questions about anything, just grab a hold of Misty, Wendy, Steve, or myself, and we'll be happy to answer your questions before you go. And once again, thank you so much for coming today.